It's lovely to be with you. Welcome back to people who have been to Keswick. Some people have been on holiday. Some people haven't been very well. So it's lovely to see you all. And also welcome to the people who will be watching online. I'd just like to, as we gather together for worship, to read a few verses from Psalm 62. And it says this: "Truly my soul finds rest in God." So if, like me, you've been running around like an idiot all week, rest in God now. My salvation comes from him. Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. So he's our strength, he's our salvation, he's our rest, our fortress, our all refuge and all of that. So it's worth praising him today. And we're going to start our service with a familiar tune. Maybe the words are slightly different. Bring to the Lord a glad new song. Let's stand to sing. You to the Prom Praise Orchestra for that. Let's just commit our time to God in prayer. Lord, touch this day with your presence, please. Touch our worship with your love and speak to each of us. Help us to make space for you to speak to us, because sometimes our lives are so full. But help us to just rest in you this morning. Guide us into knowing you more fully, loving you more dearly, and serving you more faithfully, so we can be blessed and you can be honoured. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to stand again and sing quite a traditional hymn, the New Scottish Hymn Band, "Nothing But the Blood of Jesus."
What can make me whole again?
To keep some of the people happy some of the time. It was said to me a couple of weeks ago, some of those hymns are really fast, I can't sing them. So that was a bit I don't know how sucked in you are by adverts, but you know, they're there on the telly or in the paper or on social media, you know, before and after. So, you know, the carpet that was dull and lifeless until the white clothes, you know, that were grey and drab until the car that was dirty inside and out until, you know, the vegetables in the garden that were floppy and yellow until, the flowers that were drooping until, or the pets that have got no get up and go until they start and wag their tail. You know, we add this or we take that out or we mix it together with something else or we change brands, we do all sorts of things and then it'll be all better. Or so they tell us. Well, in my experience, there's no miracle anything. Until Jesus comes into our lives and he makes the difference. We're going to remain seated as we sing, and this is going to lead us into a time of prayer. Lord, I come before your throne of grace. Faithful to us, and we need to be faithful to him in prayer. So even though I'm leading this, obviously prayer is a very personal thing. You fit in what you want to do. Let's pray together. Lord, we're glad to be in your house today. Thank you that you call us your people. You don't just expect us to believe your word, but also to share it and to apply it. So, Lord, forgive us when we get things wrong. And help us each day to live lives that are more honouring to you. Help us to recognise our responsibilities towards others. And so we pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. There's people that we know, Lord, who are dealing with health issues, some of them mild, and some of them quite serious. So we want to pray particularly for Ben and Sandra and Dawn and Peter. And there may be others that you want to just remember now. But Lord, we ask for all of these people. You would be with them and surround them with your love, first of all, and then with your healing presence. There are those, Lord, that we know who are anxious and worried about the future and perhaps about finances. We ask, Lord, that you would give them your peace, knowing that you're in total control. There are those people, Lord, that have important decisions to make and perhaps aren't sure what to do. So we ask that you would direct them. Speak to their hearts, Lord. We know, Lord, there are those who are sad and maybe feeling very lonely and isolated just now. We pray that we might be sensitive to needs and that you might be close to them. And Lord, worldwide, nationwide, even just in our community here, there are those who are hungry, those who don't have sufficient shelter, and those who are feeling perhaps dejected by their family or society. We pray that we might see needs and meet them through your love. Maybe there are those who are finding faith hard just now because of what they're going through. So we ask that you would strengthen them in their weakness. Make us, Lord, ever sensitive to the ways that we can share your love with people around us in our community, in our town. And so we do pray for our world. We pray regularly, Lord, for international leaders and politicians, diplomats, governments. They all need your wisdom and guidance, Lord. We pray for the victims of war, whose lives, habitats, countries, security, families, material belongings have maybe all disappeared. We pray, Lord, that you would comfort them and bring peace to their ever terrifying situations. As we remember these things and these people, Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. Sometimes we feel guilty because we have so much, but we know you're a God who loves and cares for each of us. So we pray that you would help us to respond to others in their need. Make us thankful people, but not just that. Make us people who are practically willing to help others, because we do it all in your name. Amen. Amen. God calls us to lives of service, doesn't he? And our next hymn reminds us of that. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let's stand to sing. reading this morning is from Titus chapter 3, quite near the end of the New Testament. Titus chapter 3, and it's entitled Saved in Order to Do Good. And this is Paul writing to Titus. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and always to be gentle toward everyone. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness and love of God, our Saviour, appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and the renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ, our Saviour, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy saying, and I want to stress these things. I want you to stress these things so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. These things are excellent and profitable for everyone. But avoid foolish controversies and genealogies and arguments and quarrels about the law, because these are unprofitable and useless. Warn a divisive person once, and then warn them a second time, and after that, have nothing to do with them. You may be sure that such people are warped and sinful. They are self-condemned. As soon as I send Artemis or Tychicus to you, do your best to meet me at Nicopolis, because I have decided to winter there. Do everything you can to help Zenas, the lawyer, and Apollos on their way, and see that they have everything they need. Our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good in order to provide for urgent needs and not live unproductive lives. Everyone with me sends you greetings. Greet those who love us in the faith. Grace be to you all, or grace be with you all. Sorry. So we'll have a little look at that a little bit later on. In 2006, St. Oswald's Hospice had a fundraising event, and there was a snow dog trail all over the northeast. In 2019, it was Elmer the Elephant. So you can imagine my delight in 2023 that the fundraising event this year is Shaun the Sheep. I like sheep. I have a few at home. I've just brought three for you to look at today. And so there's a sheep trail. It's all over the north. Well, mostly on the other side of the river, I have to say. There's one, I think a large sheep and a few, a flock of little ones in the Hilton Hotel in Gateshead. Obviously, they've got taste. So there's 115 sheep altogether, large and small, to be found and looked at. So what you do is you, well, what we do, Ian and I, Ian goes armed with his app. I go armed with my map. And we try to find all the sheep. There's quite a few of them all over the place, as I say. It's a great thing to do. So local schools and firms and individual artists decorate them, and they all have a name and they all have a number. And when you when you click on Ian's app with the number, you get this lovely sound that sends shivers down my spine. I know I'm easily pleased, but it's a good thing. And in the autumn, when everybody's had a look at them all, they're auctioned off for St Oswald's Hospice, and they make a lot of money. We've been to a couple of the auctions, and some of them go for over £1,000, a lot more than over £1,000. So obviously, it's a useful thing to do. Joking apart, sheep are important in the Bible. They're often used as illustrations, and they impact on many messages. Probably the most famous sheep is the one that got lost, and the lost sheep is he's outside the cathedral. The lost sheep is in we found the lost sheep, he's in Gosforth High Street. A couple of the church schools did the lost sheep and praise as their decoration. So just so you know, it's a good thing to do. And I know lots of you are grandparents and are maybe looking things to do with their grandchildren. Well, if somebody took me on a trail, I'd be well happy. All you'd have to do is give me a occasional cup of coffee and a bit of cake and I'd be happy all the time. But you know, we're never lost if Jesus finds us. We're never lost for long. In fact, we read in the Bible that when Jesus finds us, all heaven rejoices. So hopefully you might enjoy that. Before we turn to God's word, I am going to get a faster one in. Marvelous, wonderful, infinite God, let's stand to sing. I do like a good tune, but I always go for the words of hymns. If there's a good tune as well, that's even better. So recently I've been reading Titus and James, and I kind of noticed that they're saying similar things in each of the books. And I wondered, was God trying to say something to me? Perhaps I should share it with you. So just quickly, who is Titus? Well, he was a Greek Christian, and he was Paul's trusted traveling companion. He was an early church leader and a faithful servant of God. And Paul and Titus were really close because Paul sort of calls him his son, his brother, his partner, and his fellow worker. So Titus had traveled quite a bit with Paul. They went to Jerusalem and Corinth, and they'd been in Rome, and now they're in Crete. And as we read, Paul fully trusted Titus because he was going to leave him to continue the ministry while Paul had to leave. He had to move on, but he was perfectly happy that the church in Crete was in good hands with Titus. So Paul writes this letter not just to encourage Titus, but to encourage the believers in Crete, and I think in turn to encourage us. Titus hadn't been left a cushy number, because he had quite important stuff to do. He had to appoint elders, and that's always a bit tricky, isn't it? Getting the right person to do the job. He also had to chastise some of the people whose lives weren't shaping up to what they should be. And believe me, the Cretans had quite a reputation of being argumentative. They didn't like the fact that the Romans were ruling them, so they objected to everything that happened there. Their reputation wasn't very good at all. So I'm sure Titus didn't have a bed of roses left by Paul. I think he might have had some uneasy moments to deal with, but he faithfully obeyed God. He lays out the standards that God expects for his people. And here in chapter 3, he's pointing out what their saving faith should mean to them, and what it should, help them to live like, what they should be doing. A timely reminder, if you like, a bit before and after, like I was saying before, what we were like before God spoke to our hearts, and how we should be living in response afterwards. None of us like being reminded about things that have slipped our minds, do we? I write everything down, so I try not to forget, but I do. But here in verse 1, it says, remind the people to be subjects to rulers and authorities, to be obedient. And Titus is doing just that. He's reminding the church to respect those in authority over them. Now, during our lives, we have lots of people in authority over us. I suppose we start with our parents, and then maybe our teachers at school, maybe our bosses at work, the chairman of societies or clubs that we might belong to, even political leaders. We need to have respect for such folk, even if we don't always agree with them. As we all know, it says in verse 2 there, to slander no one, to be peaceable and considerate, and always to be gentle toward everybody. That takes a bit of doing, doesn't it? All the time. Being considerate, being at peace with everybody, it's no mean feat. The Message translation puts it like this: no insults, no fights. God's people should be big-hearted and courteous. That's kind of the lifestyle framework. And verse 3, it's where it really gets into it, and Tom Wright's translation says this, just maybe a little bit easier to grasp. We ourselves, you see, used at one time to be foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved to various kinds of passions and pleasures. We spent our time in wickedness and jealousy. We were despicable in ourselves and hated each other. Well, there's no punches held back there. And we can all see some of ourselves in some of those things. Before coming to know Jesus, we were totally different people. I don't mean we looked any different, but inside, Jesus changed us. I'm sure before we became Christians, we fed our own egos, but then Jesus changed all that. Anyway, fortunately, in verses 4-7, there's a but. Listen to these lovely words. And it's a message translation again. And it says, but when God, our kind and loving Saviour God, stepped in, he saved us from all of that, all of those things we've just mentioned. It was all his doing. We had nothing to do with it. He gave us a good bath, and we came out of it new people, washed inside and out by the Holy Spirit. Our Saviour Jesus poured out new life so generously. God's gift has restored our relationship with him and given us back our lives. And there's more life to come, an eternity of life. You can count on that. And that's absolutely true. That's the gospel just there. In other words, our salvation's all from God, nothing we do. It's all because of God's love and his mercy and his salvation that we can stand before him, forgiven people. All of that negative side of us is changed into positivity through Jesus and through his sacrifice on the cross. What a saviour, eh? However, don't get too comfortable, because there's another but, and this in verse 9, and it says, but avoid foolish controversies and genealogies and arguments and quarrels about the law, because they're unprofitable and useless. It's not all positive. We have to be careful. It's a warning against unhelpful attributes that aren't godly. God warns us not to be sucked into mindless arguments and pointless quarrels. And that often causes divisions, and it doesn't get us anywhere. I know some people are more naturally argumentative. They're like a good, you know, set to, not physically, but other people just walk away and don't want to know. But what we need to do is to concentrate on the essentials of the gospel that are for everybody's good. God's code is unity, not division. And when things fall apart, we are usually at the root cause. So we need to make sure that our lives, and some of us have been living this Christian life for a long time, it's easy to get complacent. It's easy to forget some of the very basic things that we learned when we were first brought to Jesus. And I think we've got, you know, it's good that we do remind ourselves. The final three verses are about friendship and kind of domestic arrangements that Paul's saying. I found it interesting that verse 14 says, our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good in order to provide for urgent needs and not live unproductive lives. I thought it was interesting that it says our people must learn to do good. In other words, it doesn't come naturally. Diligence isn't sort of something that's natural. It's something that we learn as we develop as people. I, for one, am very grateful that God changed me a very long time ago. I don't know what I would be like if he hadn't. He gives us the faith for all future situations. We read and we sing, we're new creations, even though sometimes, most of the time, there's powerful forces at work wanting us to go back to the way we were. There's the world in all its brokenness and selfishness. There's the flesh that sometimes gets the better of us. There's the devil. And all of these tests from time to time take us away, or try to take us away, from Jesus. And it's hard sometimes withstanding all of that. When you're in the middle of something particularly difficult in your life, a situation that's causing you worry or angst or being upset, being hurt, all of that. It's hard to see, that it's all going to work out for good. But here in the letter to Titus, Paul reminds us of how it's God's mercy that glues us together. And that keeps me going a lot of the time. I'm sure you've seen in certain supermarkets there's a certain brand of things that says taste the difference. It's a range that uses a higher quality of ingredient or claims to produce a better product. We have that from Jesus in our lives, that better quality, so that we can make a difference. Each of us, I think, needs to model ourselves on Titus's commitment to the truth and to his zeal in spreading the gospel and his enthusiastic love for other people. And I thought there was just five things, simple things that we could pull out. First of all, that salvation is all of God. Secondly, God's grace empowers our lives when we are close to him. Thirdly, remember, false teachers can be dangerous and they can spring up from anywhere. But good teachers are always God-based. And the last thing, Christian faith needs to be practically shared. It's no good us here at Beacon Lough having what we have and not trying to share it with other people. We need to do that. And the words that I read in James, I read them last week, James chapter 1, verses 19 to 21, it says this: "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger doesn't produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and all the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you." I thought that was very similar to what what Paul is saying to Titus here. So the question is, what if our church was to make a difference?
What if we were known more for what we love instead of what we hate? Would that make a difference? What if we spent more time loving people and less time being angry with them? Would that make a difference? What if we gave unconditionally of our time, our talent, and our treasures? Would that make a difference? What if we shared the difference Jesus has made in our lives and stopped pushing away those who aren't there yet? Would that make a difference? What if we walked in the steps of our Savior, sitting with the broken, caring for the poor, loving the lost? Would that make a difference? We live in the midst of ruins, surrounded by brokenness, pain, and loss. It's a moment made for us, a calling we were created to answer, not with judgment, not with harsh words or self-righteousness, but with love, the love of Jesus. What if the church acted like the church? Would that make a difference?
Hopefully it does, and we are that church. So we need to arise and put our armor on. Our final hymn, O Church, Arise. And put your armor on.
Church, arise and put your armor on. Hear the call of Christ our captain, for now the weak can can say that they are strong in the strength that God has given. With shield of faith and belt of truth, we'll stand against the devil's lies. An army bold, whose battle cry is love, reaching out to those in darkness. Our call to war, to love the captive soul, but to rage against the captor, and with the sword that makes the wounded whole, we will fight with faith and valor.
Lord, equip us through your word and inspire us through your spirit, renewing us through your grace, that we may share both in the work of Christ and the growth of your kingdom in and around the places that you take us this next week. And may you be praised and honored forever. In Jesus' name, amen.